Today, we are diving headfirst into one of the most profound, most challenging, and honestly, most mind-bending theories ever proposed about the human mind. We're talking about Julian Jaynes and his theory on the origin of consciousness. And let me tell you, this isn't just some dusty academic debate. This is a theory that, if you really let it sink in, could completely rewrite your understanding of history, of religion, of language, and even of your own inner self. So buckle up.
I want you to just pause for a second and think about this. That little voice you hear inside your own head. You know the one. The one that's narrating what I'm saying right now. The one that worries about tomorrow. The one that replays conversations from yesterday. What if I told you that voice is a relatively new phenomenon? What if for most of human history, people didn't have that inner monologue? And that when they faced a tough decision, they didn't think it over, but instead, they heard a voice, a clear, external, commanding voice that they believed was a god speaking directly to them. That is the incredible, startling idea we're going to explore.
So, here's our roadmap. First, we're going to tackle the great unsolved mystery of consciousness itself. Then, we'll introduce Julian Jaynes's absolutely radical answer. From there, we'll journey back in time to imagine life before consciousness, in a world run by a different kind of mind. We'll look at the cataclysmic breakdown that changed humanity forever, sift through the evidence for these echoes of the gods, and finally, we'll grapple with what this all means for us, here, in our own modern world.
Okay, so our starting point has to be what philosophers call the problem of consciousness. It's the 800-pound gorilla in the room of neuroscience and psychology. It's a question that has stumped the greatest minds for centuries, and as Jaynes himself put it, it's a problem that keeps returning, not taking a solution.
Here's the issue in a nutshell. How does that 3-pound lump of electrified jelly between your ears, your physical brain, produce the entire private, non-physical universe of your subjective experience? I mean, think about it. The ability to introspect, to deliberate on different options, to reflect on the past, to project yourself into the future. This gap, this chasm between the objective world of brain chemistry and the subjective world of introspectable thoughts, well, that's the problem. And mainstream science, for all its incredible power, is still fundamentally stuck on it. This is the great knot that Julian Jaynes decided not to untie, but to slice right through with a completely new kind of blade.
And this is where Julian Jaynes, a psychologist from Princeton, steps onto the stage. After decades of deep research into everything from ancient texts to neurology, he offered a conclusion that was just breathtakingly audacious. He basically said, "You're all asking the wrong question. The question isn't how consciousness evolved in our biology over millions of years. The question is, what if it didn't? What if consciousness isn't a biological feature at all, but a cultural invention?"
You can almost hear the frustration in that quote, can't you? Jaynes saw that the standard approaches were just going in circles. He saw a field tangled up in its own metaphors, assuming the mind was some kind of space that we look into without ever questioning where that space came from. His solution was to do something truly radical, to go back and read the most ancient texts of humanity, but without our modern assumption that the people who wrote them had minds just like ours.
Now this next point is absolutely 100% critical. Seriously, as Marcel, the founder of the Julian Jaynes Society, points out again and again, almost every single criticism of Jaynes's theory comes from people misunderstanding his very, very precise definition of consciousness. You see, we all have a fuzzy, intuitive idea of what consciousness means. It includes everything from seeing a cat, to feeling angry, to solving a math problem. If you use that broad definition, Jaynes's theory sounds totally absurd. So to really get what he's saying, we have to first clear the table of our own assumptions about what consciousness is not.
All right, let's break this down, because it's a bit of a mind-bender. First, consciousness is not everything your mind does. In fact, almost everything your brain does is non-conscious, from keeping your heart beating to understanding the grammar of this sentence. Second, it's not just seeing or hearing things. A frog sees a fly and reacts, but we don't say the frog is conscious. You weren't conscious of the feeling of your back against your chair until I just mentioned it, right? Third, and this is a big one, it's not necessary for learning. Think about learning to ride a bike or play an instrument. You don't consciously think, okay, now I will fire neuron A to move muscle B. You just practice, and the skill develops non-consciously. It's a process of paying attention, not of introspecting. Fourth, get this. It's not even necessary for complex problem solving. How many times have you wrestled with a problem, given up, and then had the perfect solution just pop into your head while you're taking a shower? That's your brilliant non-conscious mind delivering the answer. Fifth, it's not necessary for speaking. You don't consciously thumb through a mental dictionary for every word. You just have an intention to say something and the words just come out. And finally, the most radical idea of all, consciousness is not a biological given, it is a learned skill.
So if consciousness isn't all those other things, what in the world is it? Well, for Jaynes, consciousness is a very specific mental tool. It's a virtual space, a mind space, that we build inside our own heads using the power of metaphor. We take a physical concept, like seeing, and we create a mental metaphor like, I see your point. We take the idea of physical space and create mental metaphors like, I'm going to look back on my childhood, or I need to face my problems. This process, this use of metaphor, generates this imaginary space. And inside that space, we create a metaphorical version of ourselves, an analog I, that can move around, relive memories, and play out future possibilities. That ability, to introspect, to narrate a story of yourself to yourself, that is what Jaynes means by consciousness. It's a piece of cultural software learned by every child as they learn language. It is software, not hardware.
Okay, so if consciousness is a learned skill that's only about 3,000 years old, what on earth came before it? Jaynes's answer is a different kind of human mentality altogether, a stable and successful one that he called the bicameral mind, which literally means a mind of two chambers. Now let's be super clear here. Jaynes was not talking about primitive, zombie-like cavemen. Bicameral people were just as intelligent as we are. They had language, they felt grief, they built cities, they created art. What they didn't have was this private, internal world. They didn't have an analog eye that could introspect in a mind space.
Let's really paint a picture here. Imagine an ancient soldier, a warrior, in the heat of a chaotic battle. He's stressed, he doesn't know what to do. Now, a conscious soldier from today would retreat into his mind space. His analog eye would run simulations. Okay, if I charge, I could get killed. If I fall back, my flank might be exposed. He'd weigh the options and make a decision. But the bicameral soldier, he experiences the same stress, but he doesn't introspect. Instead, the stress itself triggers an auditory hallucination. He hears a voice, clear as day, that he experiences as coming from outside himself, from his king, or more likely, his god. The voice commands charge, and because he has no internal self to argue with it or question it, he just obeys, instantly. That voice was his decision-making process.
But how could this even work in the brain? This is one of the most brilliant and testable parts of the theory. Jaynes proposed a specific neurological model. He argued that in the bicameral brain, the two hemispheres were more separate, less integrated than ours are now. The language centers are usually in the left hemisphere, but the right hemisphere has corresponding areas that aren't typically used for speaking. Jaynes suggested that this right hemisphere area was used for something else. It organized all of a person's life experience, all the commands from parents and leaders into a guiding authority. And then, in a moment of stress, it would speak that wisdom across the connecting fibers to the left hemisphere, where it was perceived as a voice coming from God. Essentially, one half of the brain was talking to the other.
This bicameral system was incredibly successful. It was the bedrock of the great, stable, God-ruled civilizations of the ancient world for thousands of years. But it had an Achilles heel. It only worked in a stable, hierarchical society where everyone heard more or less the same commands from the same gods. Around the end of the second millennium BCE, a series of massive global catastrophes shattered that stability, and the bicameral mind began to break down.
This wasn't one single event. It was death by a thousand cuts, over several centuries. You have the colossal volcanic eruption of Thera, which sent tsunamis and climate chaos across the Mediterranean, forcing huge migrations. You have growing populations, complex trade, and constant warfare between kingdoms. Suddenly, you're interacting with people whose gods are telling them to do different things. The system is getting overloaded with contradictory commands. And then comes the real game changer, writing. The written word creates a new, silent form of authority. A command etched in stone is permanent, unchanging. It doesn't need to be hallucinated. It starts to erode the authority of the spoken, hallucinatory voices. The old mental operating system just couldn't handle the new complexity. And slowly, tragically, the gods began to fall silent.
And that silence left a huge, gaping wound in the human psyche, what we're calling that God-shaped hole. This, according to Jaynes, is the very origin of religion as we now know it. It's born from the trauma of losing that divine guidance. People became desperate to get the voices back. They started casting lots, reading sheep livers, watching the flight of birds, all forms of divination designed to get a simple yes or no from the now silent gods. They made pilgrimages to special places like Delphi to hear an oracle speak. They began to pray, pleading with the gods to speak again. They looked to prophets, those rare individuals who could still hear the voices. And they began collecting the last known words of the gods into sacred books. This deep, profound nostalgia for divine communication, this anguish, that's the engine of faith.
Now, I know what you might be thinking. This is a wild, fascinating story, but is there any real proof? This is where the theory shifts from brilliant speculation into a truly powerful scientific hypothesis. Jaynes didn't just dream this up. He assembled an incredible, multidisciplinary case, a cascade of interlocking evidence from a dozen different fields that all, strangely, seem to point in the very same direction.
Let's start with the ancient texts. Homer's Iliad, which Jaynes argues is a window into the older bicameral world, is Exhibit A. The heroes in the Iliad do not have an inner life like we do. They don't sit around and ponder their options. When Achilles is filled with rage and about to kill his commander Agamemnon, he doesn't have an internal struggle. No. The goddess Athena appears, visible only to him, grabs him by the hair, and tells him exactly what to do. The gods in this text aren't metaphors, they are the triggers of action. Now contrast that with a later text, Homer's Odyssey. The hero of that story, Odysseus, is famous for being wily, deceitful, a man of many turns. He is constantly lying, scheming, and introspecting. He has a rich, conscious inner world. The literature itself shows a profound mental shift.
And the archaeology of the ancient world suddenly looks completely different when you look at it through this lens. Those massive temples in Egypt and Mesopotamia? Jaynes says they weren't just places to worship. They were literally the houses of the gods. And the idols inside those temples? They weren't just symbols of the gods. They were the gods. We have ancient texts that describe rituals for the opening of the mouth, designed to make the statues speak. The statues were physical props, focusing points to help elicit the auditory hallucinations. It even explains why kings were buried with their entire households of slaughtered servants. It's because the dead king's guiding voice was still heard by his people, so of course he would still need his servants in the afterlife. It was a functional, not a symbolic act.
But maybe the most jaw-dropping piece of evidence comes from modern neuroscience. Remember that neurological model Jaynes proposed back in the 1970s? He said the voices originated in the right hemisphere's language area and were heard by the left. He came up with this decades before we had the technology to actually look inside a living brain and see this happen. Well, starting in the late 90s, neuroscientists like Dr. Belinda Lennox and Dr. Iris Sommer started putting people who hear voices, like schizophrenics, into fMRI machines. And the results are just stunning. When a person reports hearing a voice, the brain scans show a burst of activity in the right temporal lobe, in the exact spot corresponding to the speech area on the left. And that is immediately followed by activity in the left hemisphere's auditory centers, where the voice is processed as sound. The hard data from today's science perfectly confirms the model Jaynes predicted decades ago. It's just an absolutely remarkable scientific validation.
Jaynes's theory also gives us this powerful new lens for understanding all sorts of modern psychological quirks. He sees them as vestiges or echoes of our bicameral past. Schizophrenia, with its commanding external voices, can be seen as a kind of neurological throwback, a partial and terrifying relapse into that older mentality. Hypnosis becomes a state where you willingly give up your conscious control and allow the hypnotist's voice to become your volition, just like an ancient god. Modern practices like spirit channeling are basically just attempts to reactivate that old bicameral pathway. And you know how many young children have imaginary companions? Jaynes would say that's likely a developmental echo of a guiding external voice, a remnant of the system that we're now taught to socialize away as we grow up.
So,
If we take all this on board, where does it leave us? If Jaynes is even partially right, the implications are just enormous. It means that the very thing we think of as the core of our being, our private thinking, feeling self, isn't some timeless universal feature of being human. It's a learned behavior with a specific and relatively recent history.
I just want you to let that sink in for a moment. Your sense of you, your ability to get lost in a memory or to plan your life 5 years from now, that whole inner movie theater where you are the star, director, and audience, all of it, according to Jaynes, is a piece of mental technology that was invented out of the chaos of the Bronze Age collapse. It was built with the new tools of metaphorical language. We are not born conscious in this Jaynesian sense. We become conscious as we learn language from those around us. A child from our time raised back then would have grown up bicameral. A bicameral child raised today would learn to be conscious. That idea just fundamentally changes how we view ourselves and all of human history.
And that leads us to one last, truly mind-expanding question. If consciousness isn't the final destination of our mental evolution, if it's just one phase, one operating system that we developed, then it's a process that's still going on. Our minds went through this radical software update just 3,000 years ago, a blink of an eye in evolutionary time. So what's next? Are we on the cusp of another great mental transition? What will the human mind even be like in another 1,000 years? Jaynes's theory doesn't just offer an incredible story about our past, it throws open the door to the future of what it means to be human. And that story is still being written.
We hope you've enjoyed this look into the groundbreaking work of Julian Jaynes. Today was just a glimpse. To dive deeper, visit the Julian Jaynes Society and read his landmark book, The Origin of Consciousness in the Breakdown of the Bicameral Mind, along with the Society's follow-up works. The journey will change the way you see the mind and human history.